So if you guys can simmer down, keep your pretty cute, munching a little, try not to make too much of a mess. You know, it's not electrical. But yeah, welcome back. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the food. Real quick, a couple announcements. First, there was a question about HTML5 syntax using slashes at the end of auto close tags and stuff like that. There's a note on Piazza. If you are interested in that, you can go on Piazza and look at the note, and you'll find more information about that. Second of all, food. Hopefully you guys thought the food was fine. We will be sending out a form, like we said, about feedback for the entire day. If you have questions, comments, concerns about food, you can always put that in that form. Finally, if you have a specific dietary restriction that like you think isn't as simple as like, hey, I'm vegan or vegetarian or something like that, definitely make like a private Piazza post, and we will do our best to accommodate any kind of dietary restrictions you guys have. We want you guys to get fed. So, yeah. All right. That's all. Before I start, does anyone like as you guys were thinking over break and over like lunch break and like. Obviously talking a lot about web dev. Does anyone have any questions about anything that we've talked about today so far? About HTML, about ideation, about life, anything? No? All right, so we're gonna continue on to cascading style sheets, CSS. And basically these are the rules that tell your browser how stuff looks, okay? And so my take on CSS is basically it's just a list of descriptions. And you can kind of get this already from the name. It's like a really fancy mouthful, like cascading style sheets. It's like a waterfall of like fashion. No, it's just like, it's basically just like a lot of descriptions and they come in like a list and you just have a bunch of rules describing how things should look. And so it's interesting. We go to, I'm sure plenty of you guys see this website a lot. Probably half of you guys are on it right now. Yeah, so this website up here, Facebook, maybe some of you guys can help me out. Can someone describe what they see on this page? Guys, this is not a hard question.
There's a blue box
on the top and it says Facebook in it. Great, anything else?
Login bar.
There's a login bar. There's language preferences on the bottom.
There's a green button.
Yeah, you guys are getting a lot of these colors. Yeah, colors is obviously a part of like what describes a page. But there's other things too, like perhaps like how things are laid out, right? Like, there's so much space on either side. There's things like in columns. There's a nice amount of space around like each button. But these are all also part of things that are in like that you can use to describe the page. And so that's basically what CSS is for. And it's crazy because like this is kind of what it would look like without any CSS. And it does not look good. Yeah, it's actually amazing how much CSS does to make a website look the way it does. So it's not just a list of descriptions, it's basically just making things look pretty. And that's kind of exciting for me. I'm a front-end kind of guy, so yeah. Actually, tangent, if any of you guys are like interested or passionate about like front-end development and design, that's like me. There's a lot of back-end people here. There's a lot of back-end people in Course 6, but if you want to talk about creativity and design and fun stuff, you can talk to me, Jessica, and I, like, there's like a few of us here. We exist, it's crazy. Yeah, not just all ML monkeys. All right. Oh, what happened here? Interesting. Hold on. Uh-huh. Oh, it's blue. Interesting. Here, let's make it live coding. That's what this is. All right. So this is some CSS, right? And again, it might look a little weird. It might look a little different from something you've seen before. This doesn't actually look like most code you've probably seen because it's not real code. I don't think we're doing this real code yet. I'll tell you when you get to real code. That'll be tomorrow. I'm just kidding, this is code, but like it's not exactly what you'd expect. Hopefully they're closing the door. Okay, so basically, yeah, this is some CSS. You can already kind of get an understanding of what it is and what it does. Obviously, you can see there are some like rules here, like color is red, the font is Arial, and the font size is 24 points. But the most important part is here, which is called the selector. And the selector is basically the part of the CSS that tells the HTML what to apply these rules to. So you have like these three rules, and basically all it's saying is, hey, apply these three rules to every single paragraph tag in our HTML. So you can see this is called a property and a value, just some like nomenclature. This is just basically how you tell the HTML what you want it to look like. And there are like thousands and thousands of different properties, and we're not going to be going through all these properties, obviously. No one really even knows all of them, I'm pretty sure. To find an exhaustive list, that's what Google is for. And I'm sure like you guys will be coming over some cool ones, because there are some really cool ones that we'll be covering today and in the future. So yeah. One thing about the values is obviously the values have to make sense. So in this case, red, blue, green, these are predefined colors in CSS. You can also just give it like an hex code for like a color or something like that. But you can't say color Arial, obviously that would not make sense. So yeah, here we have our HTML again, that little document that we were looking at earlier. Now let's say we want to make it a little prettier, okay? So what we're going to do is we're just going to look at this section of it. It's just the same document, I just like cut out everything else just to focus on one part of the HTML. And we're going to add another paragraph tag called info, okay? And the reason I'm doing this is to showcase what happens when you now just add that CSS, which I just showed you. So now if we add a CSS, you can see now that the paragraph, and the info paragraph are basically now both red, which is pretty cool. And you can like see exactly how that changes. They're not just both red, they've changed fonts, they have a different size, like these are all completely different now. Okay? So that's kind of the power of CSS. And look at that, we're making our website look better already. It's like halfway to Facebook, right? Yeah, no. But basically, this is one way to apply CSS to your HTML. But maybe you don't actually want to apply it to every single paragraph element. So you can actually choose some elements that you want to apply your CSS to. So one way to do that is to use an attribute in HTML called class. Okay? So classes are basically a way to identify or describe an HTML tag. And we'll get more into like what exactly it means. But basically now what we can do is we gave it the class info, and then if we search, make our selector represent that class, then now it only applies these rules to things with that class. And so already you can see a little bit of interesting syntax here, where when you're searching for classes in the selector section of your CSS, you want to start the word with a dot or a period. And so that basically says, hey, find every single tag with the class info, and I'll apply these rules to it. So you can see now that the info paragraph got that CSS, but the paragraph is now still back to its normal style. You can also use attribute called ID. And I call this ID unique. And similarly, you can make CSS rules that look for IDs, and the syntax is slightly different. You use a pound symbol or a hashtag symbol, hashtag unique, to search for these elements. And so now it basically looks the exact same, but instead of searching using a class, you search using ID. And you're probably wondering, what's the difference? Like, why do we have both of these? And so we'll just quickly go over this, because it's actually a pretty important concept. Okay? So first of all, an element can only have one ID, whereas an element can have multiple classes. You can see this here. Basically, for these two paragraph elements, we have an ID for the first one, and we can't, like, once that ID is there, that is the element's ID. But the class, you can have like multiple classes separated by spaces in the string that's the value for the class attribute. And it basically means that, oh, I have all of these classes. And so basically, IDs must be unique in any given HTML document, but like you can use the same class on multiple elements in a document. So what that means is like we have that class called info, right? And so you can use that class on like the first paragraph, you can use it on the header, and it'll turn all of those, wherever you apply it, to that like red Arial 24-point font, okay? But that's basically how classes work. Whereas IDs, like, it's basically one element on the page has to have an ID. You shouldn't be putting the same ID on multiple elements on the page. Cool. And so once again, the syntax is when you're searching for an ID, you use the pound symbol and you use the period when searching for a class name. Does anyone have questions about that? Cool. So now we're going to touch a pretty important concept. And you hopefully, this is like a little more high level, but I think I want you guys to understand this because this is kind of getting into why we create websites in the way we do using these two different languages. And so the idea here is that tags like H1 and P, they're basically the same as div, except they have some default style. What do I mean by that? Basically, if you use CSS to style a div, right? Let's say you just applied some styling to all divs, and you made it like bold, and you made it some size font, then you'd essentially get an H1, or a paragraph, because that's what H1 does. And you can actually see this, if for those of you who using Chrome, we highly suggest using Chrome, has a really lovely tool called the Chrome Inspector. And the Chrome Inspector basically lets you look at the HTML, the CSS, the scripts running on any given page. And this is really helpful when you want to like debug things or look into how things work. And so you can use the Chrome Inspector to actually look at the default styling for a variety of different elements. And so here we have the default styling for H1 and div. And you can see that div is actually like very little styling at all. All the styling there is display block. And this is like a little confusing thing. We're not going to talk about what that really does. For now, you can just think of it as, remember, we have the nested box model. It basically kind of just says, hey, we're looking at boxes here. It's not really true, but you don't need to worry about that now. But you can see H1 has display block, but it has a bunch of other styles attached onto it as well. So the font size, the font weight, and all these weird margin things that you don't need to worry about. But basically, you can see that if we just made our own CSS rules for some div, and we could send it all div, we could apply it to an ID or a class, but you could basically recreate H1 yourself. So what does this mean? It basically means that we can build a web page using just paragraphs and H1s and then override the styling for those elements using CSS rules, right? Kind of like what we did a second ago. And this is kind of useful because you can basically get the structure of the web page and then figure out the styling a little later if that's the way you want to do it. Or you can actually build your entire web page almost entirely out of divs or span or things like that. And then you just create CSS rules for a bunch of different classes and IDs and apply those to different divs on the web page. And so you can see how that could also work. Like you just give a lot of classes and IDs to all these different boxes on the web page, and you can just give different kind of styling for all these different boxes. And you don't have to use paragraphs and H1s and things like that at all. And often it's actually just a combination of both. Because you can kind of think about it as these H1s and Ps are pre-built styling. Pre-built objects that you can use. And you can create your own objects. You can create new styles for it yourself. Or you can just redefine these styles that they've pre-built for you. Okay? This might look a little confusing. Remember, these slides are going to be online. If you like think about this for a little bit, you might, if you're reviewing this at some point, you can look back at the slide. This is an important concept because this is basically what lets you make good HTML and CSS. By having able to separate these two worlds and abstracting something out, eventually you'll be able to like change parts of how your website looks without it having to change anything in the HTML at all, because ideally you should have made it so that it's very easy to change. Take six, 6031 classes. All right, so last thing we need to do with CSS is I actually didn't tell you how you like combine these two. I just like put them side by side and said, hey, look, this is what happens when you use them together. But to actually combine them, it's just a little bit of syntax, it's not super important. But so this is our HTML document. If you wanted to actually link them CSS, because right now there's nothing telling our browser like, hey, you have to link some styles to this, you add something that looks like this. Again, it's a link tag, you don't need to close it. And basically, there's like a bunch of syntax, and you basically will always be copying and pasting this over and over again whenever you do this. You can find this online, you can find this in the slides. They have like rel equals style sheet, type equals text.css. By the way, it's totally fine to have multiple attributes. I don't think I've ever mentioned it explicitly, but that's totally okay. And then the most important one is href is style.css, and that's the file that we put our CSS code in. And in this case, we're assuming that's, of course, in the same folder as our HTML file. Again, making sure that these links actually work is important. I'm sure there'll be plenty of you guys that like be like, ah, my CSS isn't loading, and either you don't have this or you're pointing to the wrong place or something wrong is going here. So that happens a lot. Don't worry about it. Comma stick. So yeah, in conclusion, HTML is just a bunch of nested boxes. CSS is just a list of descriptions. And a description in the CSS affects a box in the HTML. Okay? Does anyone have questions on this overall model of web development program? Wow. Either you guys are really shy or just, alright. Other questions in the talk, maybe? Okay. Okay, so now that we're there, we're actually gonna start coding. It's an exciting time. So you guys hopefully have your laptops on you. Hopefully you have Git installed and like VS Code installed. We're actually not going to be using Git too much today unless you know how to use Git, in which case you can. But for the most part, make sure you have some kind of code editor and you have access to the internet, because that's important. Right. So yeah, today we're making Catbook, the perfect social media website. Yeah, it's about to start, all the puns, all right. Yeah, if you guys don't like puns, you're in for a time. Yeah, so Catbook, we're not gonna be building the whole thing today, obviously, but we're gonna start like the very baby steps. And ideally the point is, as we make our steps through this web app called Catbook, you guys should be able to start understanding how you might take your first steps through your web app that you'll be building this IAP. So yeah, it's time to get the workshop code. Alright, you can get it from weblab.to/html-workshop. Go ahead and open up that link. You'll arrive at a page that looks somewhat like this image I have here. If you know how to use Git, just clone the repository somewhere, save. If you don't know how to use Git, basically you can click on this button here, this green button called clone or download, and then you can click on download zip over here. I'm showing you this one time and one time only because you will never ever download a repository as a zip ever again in your life, okay? Tomorrow we're gonna teach you how to code. Never download repositories as zips. Terrible, terrible idea. But yeah, so just do that just today because we won't be using Git that much today. So yeah, get that downloaded, get that on your computer. Can I get a raise of hands of people who have it on their computer? All right, I'll give you guys a little bit of time. In the meantime. Raise your hand if you're a gunk code. Okay, keep your hands raised. Alright, it's like people like take some time to raise their hands. Alright, I think that's mostly everyone. That's mostly everyone, so if you haven't figured it out yet, just raise your hand and some staff will come and help you get it on your computer. So we're gonna move on. So yeah, this is exercise one. We're just getting started.
There you go.
All right, so yeah, go ahead and open up profile1.html in Chrome and see what it looks like. It should look something like this picture over here. You can open it up just by like opening your File Explorer and double-clicking on the page. Yeah, that should open it up. Ideally in Chrome. But yeah, so the first task for you guys will be to be able to change the name, the description, and the status on my profile to something that you guys want, okay? So I'll actually, just a reminder, whenever you edit any code, you can open the code, by the way, and I'll show this how this works real quick. So for those of you who just got VS Code or haven't used a code editor before, so let's say you should have this folder somewhere called HTML CSS Workshop, okay, and you should have a bunch of files in it, okay? And for those of you who have VS Code now installed, what you can do is you should be able to say, open up the app, and then click Open Folder, and then click on HTML CSS Workshop. You should find it wherever it is, and then select that folder. And then you should have all the files ready to go right here. And so you can open up profile1.html, and should see something like this. Make it a little bigger so you guys can read it. Okay? But yeah, so raise your hand if you have both it open in a web browser and open in some code editor. Cool, you guys are getting there. So yeah, once you have this here, real quick, for those of you who have not used VS Code before, it does a lot of nice things for you. If you're using Sublime, it probably does similar things. If you're using some other code editor, I hope everything goes well. But yeah, so let's just talk about this a little bit before we get into the exercise, because we can see a bunch of things that we did or talked about in our little lesson today that we started using here. So first of all, we have an image, okay, and you can see, well, first off, that image source is just some link online. So like I said, it doesn't have to be some picture that you have in your folder. It's just some link. Second of all, we have like some H1s, we have some H4s. Again, H4s are just smaller versions of H1s. We have a div. A div is just, again, kind of like a paragraph, but it's just a container. We have an HR. This is a new element that you guys haven't seen yet. It's really handy. It just basically makes I haven't opened it yet. Hold on one second. So if I open this, yeah. So it just makes a horizontal line across the page. That's what an HR does. Then another H4 for my status, a paragraph for my status, H4 for the title of my favorite type of cat, and an H3 for the cat. And so you can see exactly how that plays itself out on the page. I have here a div that I gave an ID called a profile container. Again, obviously this doesn't do anything on the web page, like you can't see anything about it. But what's nice about it is it makes some organizational things easy, which we'll talk about in a second. But now I actually want to quickly, before we even start editing some things, I want to show you how exactly the Chrome Inspector works. Because this is a tool that you will be using a lot when you're doing web development. And don't worry, we'll be touching this quite a bit. Okay, so if you right-click on the page in Chrome, there's a button called Inspect. You can also do Control-Shift-I or I think Command-Shift-I on Macs. And it opens up this little tab. It might open up to the side for you. It opens up to the bottom for me. I'm actually going to... forget where I actually document it. So I'll dock to the side so you can see it, see the entire web page. So what's nice about the Chrome Inspector is that it actually, you can see the entire HTML document right here. It basically can show you exactly what's rendering. Not just that, but it also nicely highlights everything that is rendering and where it is. So you can see here, so like this catbook H1, right? It highlights the entire title, the H1, right there. And then all this code underneath here And what's nice is, remember, I put it underneath this div, so it's like very nice and collapsible. And if I highlight over it, you can actually see that it's that nested box that wraps everything inside of it. And so obviously the nested box structure is here. We have the image, the H1, like all these different things here. And so this is kind of what's really nice about the Chrome Inspector, that like it really shows you how things are laid out in terms of the HTML. It also does a lot of things with CSS, but we'll get to that when we get there. So go ahead and go ahead and take some time and try and edit the name, the description, and the status to something of your choice. So probably your name and then like some kind of description, status. And yeah, and if you need help with any of this, again, raise your hand. There will be staff walking around to help you. So yeah, they will not be sitting over there and their laptops. Alex.
What?
All right. Okay, all right, he's gonna answer your question. But yeah, go ahead and try that. When you figure that out, we're gonna take a strat out of 031, just like kinda go like this when you're done so I can like tell when you're done. Thanks. Alright, go for it. I'll do it myself. HTML, make sure you save, by the way. One thing that you can easily tell if you've saved or not is if you make any edits, there's a little dot here over the X that like when it's done is also up here. Basically says that you have not saved. And if you don't save, none of those changes will show up. So save, and then Control S or Command S. You go to the website and you refresh. Look at that, Tatum with Master. And then the status and about me. Nice! All right, we got your own personalized profile page. Look at that, you guys are like web developers already. We're in there. So, next up. So yeah, now what I want you guys to do is change the favorite types of cats. Change to, what did I write here? Okay, whatever. instead of the H3 below the favorite types of cats, create an unordered list with your favorite types of cats. Okay, so right now it just says like Russian blue or something like that. I want you to make it into a list, okay? So go ahead and try that now. And if you forget how lists are made, you can Google it because it should be pretty easy to figure out. But go ahead and get that into your code. So while you guys type away, I'll do it up here. So if you guys are confused, you can look up. If you have no exactly what you're doing, feel free to just keep typing. And don't look up here. As you can see, one nice thing about VS Code is that as soon as you create an opening tag, it automatically creates a closing tag for you, which is really nice. But also, if you click enter, it indents everything really nicely for you. So these are just kind of things that you will get in a nice code editor that you don't get in like Google Docs or all that. So this is why we very much highly recommend things like this. So someone give me a cat type.
Mancun.
What was that?
Mancun?
That's a cat?
Yeah.
Like this?
No, Mancun. They made like the state and the Seattle Red.
Oh, I missed that. Okay. I was like, what did she say? Alright, someone else. Anyone know cats?
Calico.
Caliper?
Calico.
Dog?
Cabby.
Alright, okay. So, I don't know if I spelled caliper. I don't know. Yeah, I can. Isn't that like a thing you use in a lab?
Calico.
Calico. Okay, alright. Yeah. Cool. All right. right, so. That's one. Okay, all right. So now if we refresh, you can see that we have a nice list of cats. Question mark. But yeah, so that's how you do that. It should be pretty easy. So now you are getting the understanding of how just an HTML structure works, how to edit and play around with your website. Okay, let's move forward and try something a little bit harder. By the way, the answer is also in the slides, so if you guys are ever confused about this, you can check those out. So yeah, now we're gonna try and add some CSS. So go ahead and open up style1.css. It's in a folder called CSS, style1.css, and just take a look at it and kind of guess what will it do. Can someone tell me what it will do?
It'll open a sans serif font.
It will change the font.
It'll change the font, yes. Perfect. That's basically all it will do. There's like a cool little line up here that's just so that we get the font that I want. You don't need to worry about this right now. In general, if you want to import nice web-friendly fonts, you can go to Google Fonts and they have a bunch of them. And they can just give you a line to copy and paste in your code. But yeah, so now what I want you guys to do is add this tag to your HTML. The link, rel, style sheet, href here. I actually have it nicely copied here because I planned ahead. But go ahead and add that to your HTML. So in profile1.html, I actually like putting it in the head. You can put it in the body or the head. I believe both are fine. But this basically makes sure that like this is like one of those things that's like this is information about the page, but it isn't really in the page or in the structure of the page. So I like putting it in the head. So yeah, that. You can put that little snippet of code up there. Remember, you don't need to close it, and the href points to css/style1.css because it's in a subfolder, you notice. So yeah, and once you save that and refresh your page, you should be able to see all the font on the page change, just like you guys guessed. So that wasn't that bad. That was pretty easy. Yeah, you can see exactly what it does. And so now what I want you guys to try to do is make every single H1 element on the page blue. Okay, we did this very similar thing earlier with paragraph elements. So go ahead and try to edit style1.css and just try and make all the H1 elements blue. And then also try and make everything in the div with the ID profile container have centered text. And I actually haven't taught you how to do this because the goal is you guys will learn through Google. So try if you know how to do this already, then just do it. But if you don't know what exactly to do, go ahead and try and Google, like, how do you make centered text in CSS? And you'll probably get the right thing pretty fast. So go ahead and try that now. So I'll start doing the first one. So kind of like what we were talking about, we want to create a selector for the elements that we want to change. And we want to create a rule for that selector with the thing that you want to do, the property and value. So you want to make the color be blue. Okay. And so one thing you can already see is that, again, because we're using VS Code, it has a bunch of nice syntax highlighting and like look makes everything look pretty when you type it. It even gives you like a little preview of the color that it'll use. So that's kind of nice. So let's just test that part first. It's always good to test your code in small iterations so that you don't like make large changes and like mess things up. But you can see that just like that, we got capital to be blue, potato and master to be blue, and these are not H1, so I think that worked. The second thing we wanted to do is make everything in the div with the ID profile container have centered text. And so this is again this is the kind of thing that you can just Google. Centered text CSS. and says, hey, look, the text align property in CSS is used for aligning the inner content of a block element. So we can just do something like this. First challenge is we want to do everything in the idiv with the ID profile container. So we want to make a selector for profile container. And again, we're searching for an ID, so we use the pound symbol or the hashtag. And then we want to have a center text, so text align. Again, really nice. It just automatically suggests these things for you. You can autocomplete. If you guys ever use text editors that are nice before, you can autocomplete things just by pressing enter. So that's nice. And then if I save and go to this website again and refresh it, like that. Now everything is centered. And you'll notice that everything is centered in that div with the ID profile container, but the thing outside of it is not. So does everyone understand that? Does anyone have questions about that? Because there's some important concepts going on here. First of all, we have multiple H1s on the page, so as we saw, it affects every single H1 on the page. Second of all, we looked for this div with the ID profile container. So technically we applied the styling to the div. But what actually happened is everything inside the div got that styling as well. And this is kind of how CSS works. We're gonna use some terminology here. In HTML, like, elements have children and parents. So anything inside one of those nested boxes, anything inside a box is a child of that box. So basically what happens in HTML and CSS is that children of an element receive the styling of the parent element. So like we gave this div the profile container ID, and it got some styling from our CSS, and that gets applied to every single thing inside. Now this is actually where the inspector comes in really handy again, because you can actually see, if I zoom in here, there's not just the HTML here, but there's something called styles. Okay? And your inspector might be able to format it a little differently. You just kind of got to search around for the styles. It might be here, it might be here. But in styles, you can actually look at the CSS of an element. And so we can see that this div, which is now currently selected, has this CSS. It actually tells you exactly what line and what file it comes from. It's getting the CSS text align center because it has the ID profile container. This is extremely useful for debugging things and basically making sure that your CSS is working properly and applying to the elements that you want them to apply to. And so if we now look at something like this image, just like that, now we can see we clicked on this. You can see that this also has text align center, but it says inherited from div ID profile container. And basically it's exactly telling you where it got the styling from. And again, this is extremely useful when you're starting to like have all kinds of styling all over the page, and some things are overriding other styles, and like you're wondering where did it get the styling from. You can always look into the inspector, and it'll tell you exactly where it came from. And don't worry, we'll be playing around with this even more. Cool. So now that we have that all set up, centered, all that stuff, we can move ahead. Does anyone have any questions about anything so far? No, solid. Okay. And again, I apologize if this is slow for some of you guys. We just want to make sure that everyone in the class gets like the same like experience and exposure to this material. And don't worry, it's still gonna be a fast course because we're diving into like React in a week, and that's like crazy. So this is the solution to that. H1 color blue, profile container, text align center. It should result in something like this. And so yeah, you're probably feeling a little good right now, so we're gonna move forward. Wow, you guys don't laugh at my jokes. I'm sorry. Okay. Anyways, you can now go ahead and open up profile2.html and style2.css in your code editor, and then look at profile2 in a browser. So I'll do that too. Quick trick, you can just change the last thing in here to profile2, and I'll show you profile2. Wow, fancy, happy man. And then you can just open up profile2 and style2.css. So if we actually look at the web page, you can see a few differences already. I think I actually have it in the slides. Okay, we're going to walk through the CSS changes, and I'm going to switch the code. Add reminders to myself. It's nice. So you can see the cat book is still blue. We got rid of this text centering for some reason. We'll get to that in a bit. Rupayan Niyogi, my name, is now red. We have some nice like boxes around these elements over here. So yeah, let's talk about what kind of changed. So if we go to this HTML, it's actually mostly the same. We have a couple new divs here with some classes, and yeah, we have like this class called card. We have like an ID here, an ID here. So a couple different changes. So we'll look into that in a little bit. But more importantly, we added some new style. So here we have a new rule for anything with the ID name. It says, hey, make it red. We have a new rule for anything with the ID name container and make that green. And we have a class selector for anything with the class card. And basically it says, well, a few things. It says border width 1 pixel. And this is a property that basically gives something a border. It makes that box. That's where that box came from. And border style solid is just saying make that a solid line. You can make it a dotted line if you want. You can do a bunch of cool things with that. And it gives something called padding. And we're going to talk about that in a second. But let's start with these things, okay? Because it's actually kind of important. So my name here is Red, okay? Which is somewhat, might be a little surprising to me because my name here, it's an H1. Let's find it. Name container. Yeah. So this is an H1. And if you remember, I made H1s be blue. So this one's red. So that's kind of weird. I don't know exactly what's going on there. It's also inside name container. So maybe it should be green. But it also has an ID called name. So maybe it should be red as it is. Now obviously you can see that one of those won over all the other things. Namely the name ID selector. And so this is an important concept of how basically the CSS inheritance works. Things often override each other, but it overrides it in a pretty logical way. And that is, the more specific the selector is to an element, the more likely, or like, the most specific one will be the one that applies to the element. So we can actually go ahead and look into the CSS in the inspector, and you can actually see how exactly this overriding is happening, which is really handy. So again, we have, we selected this H1 element, and you can see it's getting the color red from the ID. Okay, so it has the ID name, and it's getting the name ID from the 15th line of style2.css. You can see it actually overrode, it also inherited this, but overrode the styling for H1. And so you can already see one level of overriding. So where like the H1 is more general than a specific ID. And if you remember, that's because IDs are unique. So that's actually one of the most overpowering kinds of CSS rules, because if there's only one ID on the page, there could be multiple H1s on the page, the more specific rule overrides. So we have this color being red instead of the color being blue. But even lower, you can actually see, well, first of all, one thing that you want to notice is like this is that default H1 styling that we talked about earlier. It's all here. But even lower, you can find that color green. And this is again because it inherited this from the container it's in, that name container that we have surrounding it, this little div. And I said, for anything in this div, make it green. But because we made this kind of thing have an H1 and have an ID with name, that value, that color basically gets overridden. What's interesting though is that, first of all, this is a handy trick. If I just like go into my HTML and change something, so let's say I added like a paragraph element and say, this should be green. And save that, and refresh. It's really hard to see, but that is in fact green, you gotta trust me. But yeah, that's basically green text. Actually, if I just make this like H2. Okay, and maybe that'll be easier to see. Yeah, so you can see that that actually works. It gets the inherited color, and if I inspect this, you see it gets it inherited from the name container. Whereas this, instead, has this level of overriding. So does everyone understand that? Does anyone have questions about how this overriding works? There's a lot of like weird, finicky things about this. Anyone? Cool, I'm sure you guys will come to office hours when you guys run into all these kinds of problems. But yeah, so that's how that works. So now let's talk about the card. So here we have, back to this. We have a div with the class the card, and then we have the paragraph inside. Okay? And so several things happen with this card. The border width is 1 pixel, so you can see if you hover the card, there's a nice border around it. That's that like little line. If I change this to like 10 pixels, you can then see that the card gets a bigger width. And also, real quick, important note, you can see that it actually applies to all the cards, which is useful. Because if you want your website to look uniform, you want things to happen a lot. And so because this is a class, we apply the class, this card class to multiple different elements on the page and applies to all of them. The border style is solid. I think dotted is one of them. You can like basically see, you can just change the style. That's one of them. There's a bunch, there's dash, but we're gonna go solid for now. And then we have this element called padding. So let's talk about this for a second. So basically everything in HTML and CSS follows this box model. I've already been talking about this whole idea of nested boxes, but we're going to have boxes in our boxes now, so it's going to be crazy. But the idea is that every single tag, every single box that we create actually has multiple kind of layers. And the inside, the very most inner layer, is the content, whatever is inside this box. But outside of that, we have multiple things. We have something called padding, we have something called the border, and we have something called margin. And basically all this is saying that like the border that we have, the border is that like outline of the box. That's kind of like exactly what the box is, most literally. And padding is basically space inside the box so that like your text doesn't like touch the border. It's basically just to make things look aesthetic, because you don't want like your C in like some word or some letter in some word touching the line at the end. So everything usually has some padding. And then margin is space outside of the box to make sure that your box doesn't touch other things, okay? Because you don't want like all your cards like touching each other very close. And so we can actually go ahead and see this. This is another really good thing about the inspector. Is that so I'm gonna play around with this. So first of all, you can actually edit all these values in the inspector itself. So I can make this border width 20, and you can see a live update. This is extremely handy for like debugging things, okay? Or like testing out your design, because you can like see what you like enjoy or what you think is a good look, and you can experiment with that here. But one thing though is that this doesn't actually edit the actual style sheet. So once you edit things here, if you refresh, they'll just go back to what it was before. You actually have to edit things in your style CSS. And this makes sense, because you don't want to be editing things in Chrome. So yeah, like let's make it like a nice 5 pixels. Maybe I like that. And maybe I like, maybe I want this to be like dashed, right? Cool. And then this is the one I wanted to talk about, is the padding. Because if you see, if I make the padding be 0, you can actually see, yeah, see this T in today? I can zoom this in. This T in today is touching the border, which is not really a nice thing. So you often add padding to elements to make sure that like, they don't actually touch the edge. And one thing that's nice is if you actually hover over it, the Chrome actually shows you exactly where that padding is. It's that little green outline. And that's the box model. The blue is the content, the green outline is the padding, and the yellow is on the border. And then one thing we can also add is margin. We can add a margin of like 20 pixels, okay? And you can immediately see that these little boxes jump out a little more. And that's exactly what margin does. And you can also see that here. Is it like that darker orange yellow shows the margin, the yellow shows the border, the green shows the padding, and the blue shows the content. Okay? And you can start to see how this can be useful, especially when you're trying to make your website look pretty and like not look cramped and things like that. So does everyone understand that? Does anyone have questions about that? Because one of the things you will start to notice is that like every single element that you touch basically in like this page has these things already built in. This is kind of what we're talking about. Like a paragraph element has some default margin on both the top and the bottom. Okay? And that kind of makes sense because you're making a paragraph, you don't want it to be too close to other elements in the page. Okay? Similarly, an HR is that horizontal line, but that's all the line is, but it has some spacing on top and bottom to make sure that nothing touches it. And finally, you can actually see that box model if you just scroll down in the styles window, and you can actually see exactly the box right here. So it says 20 pixels of margin, 5 pixels of border, 10 pixels of padding, and 663.143 by 53.714 pixels of content. So yeah, super handy if you're really into like pixels and stuff like that. It can be really nice. This is what like designers spend a lot of their time on, just making sure everything's nicely spaced out. Cool. So now that we have that set up and you understand what's going on, time for you guys to do some more stuff. Try and go ahead and make a class called TextCenter in style2.css, okay? And basically, all it is like a class that makes everything in it have centered text, okay? And I want you to add that class to the div with the ID profile container, okay? And that should, in theory, center everything inside that div. So go ahead and try that. And if you have questions, staff will be helping you. So, it's always sitting here.
Thank you.
CSS to this ID, created a rule for the ID profile container, and this time we're applying CSS for this class called TextCenter. And what's nice about this is this class is very reusable, whereas an ID is unique on a page, so once you use it once, you can't use it again. And so why I say this is because let's say we didn't want to apply to this div, right, and we didn't want everything in it to be centered. Let's say I just want this to be centered, then I can do class equals TextCenter. TextCenter, and then maybe I want my about me to be TextCenter, then class equals TextCenter, and so now you can see, Capbook centered, about me centered, I can center some other things, but you can see how like this is good like coding practices in the sense that it's very reusable, it's very like self-explanatory, it's like semantic. Like you read this and it says, hey, this class, this element has a class called text center. I bet this text is centered, right? So like, this is the kind of thing that you probably want to start getting used to when you're creating CSS, is not creating CSS for like different elements, but for creating CSS for ideas, like such as a card. Card is an idea, and every time you want to create a card, you use this basically black box that is a class called card, and I'll basically make a card for you. And that's basically how you can start making better CSS for your HTML. Alright, so now that we figured that out, let's move forward. So, don't worry, we only have a little further now. At least grown, like, I'll take that, you know. Okay, so yeah, let's talk about border radius, okay? So, Alex Chen. We're gonna open up profile 3 and style 3.css, and we can go to our browser. And again, you can open this up just from Explorer, or I can just type 3 here. And so yeah, again, it's pretty similar to what we had before. Everything's centered now, but our nice card here has a nice little feature. You can see that these curves are really like, or these corners are now nice and curved, but super aesthetic and like modern. Like we're really getting to like Facebook now. We're like nearly there, guys. So now it kind of actually looks like a card, you know? And this is just a little fun thing. Like I said, there are a lot of different CSS properties, and one of these is called border radius. And so you can see here that we just added this thing in step 3 called border radius 5 pixels, and that basically rounds out the corners of this card. And once again, you can actually inspect this card. You can see in the CSS, there it is, border area is 10 pixels. And let's see what happens if we change it. So if you make it 50, you'll see it's much, much rounder. If you make it 0, it's just a rectangle, okay? And so again, like, you can start like thinking, how round do you want this to be? Like, you can also notice that, like, if I made it really big, it doesn't actually start changing anything. And you can start wondering, okay, how does this actually work? What does it do? Basically, the radius at the corner is valuable. But so I like maybe the 5 is really small. Maybe I want like 20. Yeah, 20 looks like a nice value. So again, I found this nice border radius that I like, and then that's not actually going to change anything. So I have to go to the CSS, change it there. Now if I refresh, it's all set. It stays the same. Okay. So we have border radius, and what else did I add in step 3? So the text center. This is basically that class that we described earlier. One thing to keep in mind is I created something called TextLeft. Just as an example, this is just another class that is similar in idea. So you can start applying styles based on class names, which is more of an idea than like just using CSS, which is more of a descriptor. So yeah, let's do the next task, which is going to be make your profile picture round. Okay? So go ahead and use the border radius property and give your profile picture a nice like curved corner. You can either add an ID to the image and apply the CSS to the ID, or you can do what I've been telling you and you can create a class representing rounded edges and add the class to the image. So go ahead and try that right now. So again, this is not super complicated because we just did something like this, but I'm going to go ahead with my class model and say rounded image, and basically I'm going to say border radius is, say, 25 pixels. Okay. Oh, that's a good amount. If I refresh, nothing happens because, I just made it. I actually haven't applied this class to anything yet. You go to the image, say class equals rounded image. Okay? Now if I refresh, you can see that our nice cat has some nice rounded image on the picture. Isn't that really nice? We're like looking professional, right? So again, this is something that you can play around with in Inspector. Inspect it, I can create this, make it like 5 pixels for a really small thing, or like 100 pixels for a very round thing. Let's make it very big. And so this comes back to something we were talking about earlier, is that no matter how big it gets, you see that it kind of stops at some point. But like, this is as round as it will get. And you can kind of understand why, because it's creating basically an arc of a circle at the edge. And after this amount, it can't create a larger circle because the max width of the image, which is the smaller dimension of the image, is now equal to the diameter of the border radius. If that makes sense. 2 times border radius. Don't worry about that too much, but basically the idea is like this will only get you so far, right? Like you can make it very round and now it looks like a nice pill, but that's the most you can get it to be round. So the question is, what if I wanted it to be fully round? But before that, actually I remember something before that. I also have an example here, okay? Where I show how one way you can do it, okay? I mentioned two ways you can do it. You can create HTML, or there's like really three ways, or there's lots of ways. But you can create some CSS for an ID, you can create some CSS for a class, you can, in fact, create CSS for every single image, and say every image element has rounded edges. But what I did here is different. See, in the HTML, actually, I created a new attribute in the image element called style, and gave it some CSS inside the HTML. So this is interesting because you can do this, but I'm gonna tell you right now, never do this. This is terrible. We were just talking about so much about how you wanna separate the CSS from the HTML, how they're two different things that work together, but really shouldn't necessarily be like completely dependent on each other. And this is exactly one example of how code bases can become extremely difficult to read, extremely difficult to understand how things are working. Because if you start sticking styles in HTML like this, imagine when you have extremely large HTML files and extremely large CSS files, and you're looking at some element on your page and you're wondering, where is this styling coming from? And you go to the CSS and you can't find it. This can be really problematic. This is also not reusable at all. Like, the only way to like start using another thing that has the same border radius is to copy and paste this code and put it on another HTML element. And that's not good. That's like basically can be prone to errors. Now imagine if you have like 50 tags in your HTML that all you want border radius 50, but then you decide, hey, I actually want that border radius to be 30. And I have to go to 50 different places in your HTML and change that, and you probably just miss some because that's how coding works. So this is like a lesson not in web development, but just in coding practices. Try and like abstract these out. Don't be doing things like, if things are repeating a lot, you're probably doing it wrong. And so making like classes, which are basically kind of like variables for that contain styles, that's a much better way of applying styles throughout your website. So yeah, don't do this. So yeah, what are they talking about, okay? Gotta stay positive. Yeah, that's what I was talking about. All right, thank you, yeah. Oh. Amazing. What about we wanted to try making a perfectly circular image, right? And like that, so that's something we could figure out with border radius, even though it feels like you should be able to. So see profile for HTML and style for CSS. So, well, first of all, let's go to profile4.html. And look at that, we actually have a nice, beautiful, circular, perfectly circular image. And then let's look at the code. Profile4.html. Whoa, there's no images anymore. Weird. Okay, we'll figure that out. Style for CSS. Whoa. Okay, so we have a lot more CSS now, and like the image disappeared from the HTML, and like I have no idea how this works actually. Well, I do. But like, it's like you look at it and you're like, what is going on, right? And so the question is, at some point you're starting to wonder like, okay, like I wanted to make a perfectly circular image, how did this guy up here figure out how to do that? Like this, like I would never figure out if me being you, this is bad English. If you were there, you're probably looking at me wondering how did this guy figure it out? As a student in this class, I don't think I would figure this out very easily. The answer is Google. It's like I literally copied and pasted this code from like Stack Overflow. This is the thing about web development, especially like CSS stuff. Like, and there's so many different things that you can do with CSS, and it's actually basically impossible. Like, I can pretty guaranteed say, like, no one on this planet knows every single thing about CSS. Like, it's really hard. But, like, you can, maybe someone does. I don't. But basically, the idea is this. This thing that I have here, all I did was basically search like how to make a perfectly circular image in CSS, right? And like, like, you get some answers that are rounded images. These aren't right because these are talking about border radiuses and things like that. But I think it was this one. Yeah, look at that. There's like a bunch of things here. I don't know if this is right. But basically, you can find a lot of these answers just by doing things. And this one actually has a JS fiddle. This is in circular. They lied. Okay. But basically, the point is you can find a lot of answers online. They might not always be great. That's the truth of it. Like, some answers are just wrong. But as you get more used to doing this kind of development and doing more research using Google effectively, you'll start to understand where you can find reliable resources and what is actually... You also start learning how to make better Google searches to find the results that you're looking for. So yeah, I'm not actually going to go over this completely. Like, if you actually want to know how this works, maybe in office hours or something like that, or like after class. But high level, you set the background image to like some image instead of like setting it to an image, and then you like center it on that, and then you make the container circular. Not important, okay? So what is important, though, is that the internet is your friend, okay? So make sure you guys are using the internet wisely during this course, because you're going to use it a lot. So that's what your next task is. Go ahead and use the internet to make something, anything, cool, and add it to your app. Make sure only to use HTML and CSS. Don't touch JavaScript yet. That's tomorrow. But you can go ahead and search, like, if you anything you can think of. Like, I want to make this fly over there, or I want to make this, like, be a different color, or, like, I want to make a rabbit pop up on my screen. Like, anything you want. Just, like, you can Google it and, like, kind of think about how you want to phrase that Google. If you are having trouble with ideas, you can go to some, like, websites like css-tricks.com or Stack Overflow, and there's, like, plenty of, like, cool examples on these websites of things you can do just with CSS and HTML. And if you can't think of something, go ahead and just like Google element hover or CSS animations, and you'll probably find something cool from there. So go ahead and try that now. I'll go ahead and try something myself. You want music? Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. It's like, there's like a date that's like, do not let us start your website until like January 7th, 2018.
Oh no!
There's like a bunch of links that are really good. Also, our fab icon is white.
Yeah.
And the Chrome browser is white. So it just shows up as white. Before I discuss it.
I was thinking about that one. I did not know there was.
I don't know, ask text information.
Alright, so hopefully you guys have found something cool. Does anyone want to share their things? I guess not. I have some fun things, but there's a lot of cool things out there. If you guys ever want to, one thing that we highly encourage in this class, and I just made this up on the spot, but I'm still going to say we highly encourage in this class, is sharing the things that you do. So if you guys ever make anything cool, and once we teach you how to host things, feel free to like, and even if it's like not your final website, feel free to like share like these files on Piazza or little code snippets on Piazza with like helpful hints for your friends. Because like, we're in this together, guys. It's a month long hackathon. It's gonna be great. All right. So yeah. So what did I do? I did some fun little transition animation stuff. So you can see if I hover over this cat, like it turns right. Ooh. Ah, it's so fun. Yeah.
Oh, well, that's cool.
And then like if you hover over this card, it like grays out a little bit and transitions over, and it's like actually looks really nice. It's like very interactive, like almost like I would want to click on this except that button. But yeah, so like how did I do this? Well, I know a few things. There's this wonderful world called CSS animations that basically lets you do a lot of very interactive things that look like it might take something like JavaScript to do, but you can build really complicated interactions with your web browser just using CSS. And so this is just a little snippet into it. But the idea is that what I first did was, let's talk about the card. So there's this selector called hover. And this is really nice, basically, in the sense that if you hover over an element, this style gets applied to that element. So basically this is saying that, okay, if I hover, which basically means moving my mouse over, if I hover over anything with the class card, I want to give it this particular rule, which is saying the background color of that card should be this color, which is just some gray color. And so you can see that happen right here. What's also nice is you can tell that like it also kind of fades in and out, which is a nice little feature. That's done by going to the actual card itself and adding this property called transition. And basically, it says transition 400 milliseconds, and that gives it a nice smooth fade. Again, you can inspect this all in real time. So if I actually look at the card itself, okay, I can make that transition be like 1,000 or like 2,000 milliseconds or 2 seconds, and you can actually see like it's a nice, like very slow animation, but it still works perfectly fine. And also, one thing that I wanted to show that I didn't show earlier. I can't do it here. But what I'll do right now is I'll say background color, and let's make it just gray. That's pretty funny. Like, as I change the color, it actually does the transition. Look at that. Isn't that crazy? Magic of CSS, right? But yeah, so like, there's a gray here. Apparently, these are all pre-made grays that exist in CSS. Why? I don't know. But like, you can pick these colors. Let's say light gray is the one I want to go to. But what you can also do in Chrome is you can actually click this, right? And then you can actually just pick the color you want to change it to. And like there's a whole palette, it's like the full color palette of things that you want to change it to. And this is really handy because you can now like very visually test exactly what you like and what you want just through Chrome. And this is a really good way to design like the UI, the colors, the scheme of your website, just by editing things in Chrome. And once you've found something you like, maybe I like this kind of light blue color. By the way, you can also like pick a color using this. So like, let's say I want the green from here. You can make it like this gray-green color. But I'm gonna go back to that blue because I like that. Okay? You can actually just copy that color to the clipboard, or you can just copy it from here. And once you copy it, you can just paste it. Again, Visual Studio Code is very nice, so it actually previews the color for you. Now if I refresh, look at that. Works. Crazy, right? So this is the kind of like cool stuff you can do with that. I'll really quickly go into this one as well. It's a similar idea, using the hover thing. I added a transition to the card. Or not the card, this is, what is it, the image? Yeah, div.circleavatar. You don't have to worry about the rest of this, but I added this one line down here that says the transition is now 500 milliseconds. Again, the one thing about this is like if I make this zero, right, or if I just delete this line, right, you can, that's okay. It's very empty. Nothing to hide there. Here it is. So if I refresh this now, it just immediately transforms into that 90 degree rotation. That's why like the transition property is actually super nice. It makes everything look really smooth. So you can imagine already how your website will have all the things sliding on and off as you like scroll up and down. It's crazy. But yeah, so let's put that transition back in 500 milliseconds. And the one thing that I did is basically again on the circle avatar hover. If I'm hovering over anything with this class, there's a nice property called transform, and you can give it a rotate and degrees. There's all kinds of things. You can do like translate, image translate? Take it. There's no translate. Oh, there definitely is. Oops. What am I doing? that was good. Let's see. This is what happens when I try to do things in real time. So 50 pixels, maybe? Question mark? I don't know if that actually works. Oh yeah, look at that. Now it like slides to the side. So these are all things that you can do using lots of different properties using CSS. And I would highly recommend anyone who's interested in like these kind of design kind of things, check out that website called css-tricks.com. It has like a lot of stuff, like basically covering everything from these kind of cool animations to how to use advanced features like Flexbox to how to center anything anywhere on a page. Like there are tools and you'll definitely run into it while you guys make your website. So yeah, that's that. And now that you're done with that, you're now a CSS master. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, look at that. You now know a tiny bit.
What the heck?
Yeah, they're haters. So now you guys hopefully know a little bit about CSS. By the way, I think if you want to see, something for the final one. I have style5.css and profile5.css, and that just has a few examples. I didn't put the rotation thing in there, but I think what I put in there. Oh yeah, this now rotates all the time, and it has this little hover. Yeah. This won't make you dizzy at all. It's like, what did they say in that trailer? They're like, it looks into my soul. that's that. So yeah, you can check that out on your time in profile5.html. But yeah, so back to the presentation. So yeah, there's some advanced topics, and I'm not gonna really talk too much about this, but basically this is just for if you're curious, if you wanna learn more, you can look at these slides and Google this stuff on your own. But some things involve position, which is really useful for like laying out things on your page. There's something called, which basically you can see like there's like things like absolute, relative, things like that, but basically, it lets you place things in different places inside of a box. This thing's called float, which lets you kind of float things to the right or left of places. It's good for like having images inside text. It's good for having boxes inside boxes in general. Now there's also something called z-index, which lets you layer things on top of each other. Again, you can imagine like having like background of grass and then having a bunny on top of it. I don't know why I would go to the bunny. But like basically you have a higher Z index for the bunny and it'll actually render on top of the grass. There's something called Flexbox. You can see that was the last big pancake that that bunny ate. Yeah, it's a time. It's a little difficult to understand, but once you get it, you can really, really like get a huge grasp, a good grasp on like how to kind of lay anything out on a web page exactly as you want it. And it's really, really powerful. And we'll be talking about Flexbox at a later lecture. There's something called media queries. And basically, this is for making your website be useful and functional on all kinds of devices. So things with different screen sizes. So you can look at your website on a web, on a computer, a desktop, or a laptop, but you can also look at it on a phone, or maybe a tablet. And these all have different screen sizes, and you can think about, hey, maybe my website should look different on different screen sizes, maybe the text should be bigger. And so what media queries allow you to do is change the styling based on like the width or the height or the size of the screen. There's also like other ways to do this, but like this is just like, a quick glimpse into like how to start designing for multiple devices. And one thing to mention is, while we don't really expect any website to be responsive, by the way, responsive is the word that basically means mobile friendly or like screen size friendly in web development. We don't expect any of your websites to be responsive. It's definitely a plus. It's nice, and especially if you're making an app that might be like makes sense to be used on a phone, you might want to think about whether that's one of those key features in your MVP or even in your final product that you want to be going for. And I promise you, it's always much, much easier to make your website for mobile first instead of making your website and then trying to turn it into a mobile website, because that's actually really hard. There's also something called CSS frameworks and libraries. Maybe you've heard of them, something called Bootstrap, there's something called Foundation, Semantic UI. These are basically pre-built things to help your CSS look better, or help your website look better by giving you some pre-built CSS. And that's actually what we're going to talk about next. But before we do that, I think we can give you guys a quick 5-minute break, and then we shall reconvene with some of that.